amazing panel made up of this remarkable gentleman. Please put your hands together for the last time. Okay, so the MC or the host, rather, already introduced all of them, but I will just do a quick recap of everyone that is here. So to my immediate right, is Olufemi. Oguntamu is the media strategist and talent manager, popularly known as Penzaar, and is known for the catchphrase, "Let's do more." Please round of applause for him again. And then to my far right is my brother and friend, is an influencer as well. He's been in media for years, Pamilerin, Adegoke, popularly known as Pampa. Okay, to my left, I have Tunde, TNT. Okay, he's the brain behind Street Church, a brand that I'm very conversant with. I love the Street Church because I'm passionate about the gospel, like I said earlier. So today it's great to have you here. And to my far left is Taiwo, right? Taiwo manages Hollywood actresses, like Ense is a media big wig, like you call him. And he's also going to be on this panel today. So please just be trying to have time. All right, so we're here to discuss virality in content creation. By the end of this discourse, I hope that we'll be able to shed more light on what, you know, virality in content creation entails, and you leave here with more knowledge than, you know, before you got here. Okay, today in the arts of business and content creation, it's evolved over the last decade. Media platforms over the years now use podcasts, newsletters, shorts, views, status updates, and all these things have affected the way that we consume media today. Also, content creation has evolved in terms of access, thanks to smartphones. Gen Z today, from the comfort of their rooms, can share a video. You see people share a video that they didn't even think would go viral, and before you know it, it has millions of views, right? And this views ends up affecting the top line of the businesses that they work with, so to speak. So as technology is constantly evolving, there's a need to stay ahead of that curve, know what works, what doesn't work, and then why this discussion is very paramount. So, to start off, what my first question will be to you, because you're right beside me. So, to start off, what are the significant changes in content creation, in the content creation industry today, compared to what we had a decade ago?
Good morning, everyone. Okay, yeah, so, I'll say that content creation now is different from what we had before. Now the virality is a thing now. I mean, anyone can stay at home and just do a short video, and then it's everywhere. You can reach a larger audience now in the tip of an eye, and you don't need to necessarily use a camera or a big production, you know, to create content. You can just use a smartphone. Everyone now can afford iPhone or Samsung and all that, smartphone basically. Now, content is, so initially, content used to be something too serious, you know. Maybe you need to start thinking of ideas on the kind of content you create, or, and then it used to be very serious. But now, someone can just work online and it's a content. Someone can just do like this and it's a content, you know. So, content creation now defines you. You can be anything as long as you are consistent with that content, and then the aim is to go viral eventually. So I would say that what has changed is that the kind of content we create now is now more spontaneous and more flexible than it used to be, and then we can reach a larger audience now than before, you know. So yeah, I've got several platforms now. Initially, content creation was, I think, for me, it started on and BlackBerry for me. Then over time, we moved to Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. Now we have YouTube, we have TikTok. You know, we've got a lot of platforms. So basically, yeah, that's it.
Thank you so much, Penzaar. I totally agree, right? 10 years ago, we didn't have TikTok, we didn't have Instagram. I think we had Instagram 10 years ago. Did we?
10 years.
Yeah. Oh, okay. I guess I'm old. Okay, so, but yeah, now for the spaces of people's homes, they can easily just put out content, and I think that that's really, really amazing. Okay, Tunde, do you want to just comment on that? Brings me to you, okay, not full time, but I mean, he has other hustles. I'm aware of that. But Pamilerin, you came into fame through social media. You're an engineer, I think married engineering, right? But today, people know you as Pam Pam on social media platforms, and you've over the years done a lot of influencing, and you understand media, so to speak. So, do you want to tell us how it has been, how that career shift for you has been as from an engineer, married engineer, to the content creator who is respected in that field?
I think it's just basically what I love doing. It's kind of easy, you know, right now to start thinking of what area is this going into, or without marrying, whatever happening. I can sit anywhere, create content from anywhere in the world, and boom, like, you're getting paid. When others are, you know, running to waiting for their paycheck at the end of the month. with a doctor, with a lawyer, with an engineer. You know, so for me, it's a good one. If at the other part is you making a name, but you might make a name and you come out of that, trust me, you are good to go.
Thank you so much, Pamilerin. I mean, there are a lot of young people here. Clap, if you want to clap. There are a lot of, I mean, there are a lot of young people in the audience, and I'm sure that they can learn one or two things from this, because things are changing. They're not what it used to be. We're no longer in the days where everybody wants to be a doctor, a lawyer. There are so many career paths. Of course, don't get me wrong, these career paths are amazing, but this is the tech age, right? And things have, you know, changed tremendously. Okay, so to my next question, having we started with you today. Oh, I mentioned that I like your brand, right? Street Church, amazing work you're doing with that. So, what implications do viral media, text, videos, audio formats hold for personal and business branding in the global lives?
So, I think, well, implications in terms of these negative implications or positive implications, which of them are.
I think you should shed light on those because, of course.
All right, you know, so for positive implications, I think viral content. Very important in the globalization of brands, even as an entire ecosystem of the nation, you know, both from governments to politics. I mean, we all see the impact of content on politics nowadays, we see the impact of content on different business and the economy. So I think the implication for I'll take Street Church as an example. My friend, with my partner, Tunde, started Street, founded Street Church. And he started Street Church from the place of the personal conviction, you know. And on this start point, he was able to, in his mind, connect what exists as your district, you know, or your local culture as well, your local environment, connecting it with what the Bible says. That's one of the first viral content that went out was Google Amateur Breakfast and the trend there. And he chopped a post with the Bible verse and about groups basically saying that an appointed time for something will happen, you know, just perfect. So something is a time that something is set up, you know. And when he put that out, a lot of people saw Google Amateur Breakfast in different languages. But being able to finish that passage, you know, give them a different perspective. To be honest, I mean, everything happens when I'm going to somebody with breakfast by 7 a.m. and another person might breakfast by 10 a.m. You know? So, I mean, from a positive perspective, that content has a positive impact on people. It changes the narrative of things, and that's what one of the things that we do in our future, you know. And there's also the side of negative issues. How do we see content on the bar, like everywhere? So, especially Twitter. Twitter people are very used to it. So, now content that victims everywhere, you know, and that can sort of like spike up fear, you know, within people, and it sort of like gets people into spaces where they are becoming very scared, you know. And I mean, just before I came up, I saw a picture of someone posted saying that U.S. Marine officer now in Abuja, something like that. I don't know why, guys. We really don't know how true that is. What you think, but you pass that information through social media, you know, tend to create content that and provide it to that negative impact, you know, on society, you know, like, I mean, every place that you choose as a community brand, I mean, politics, like I said earlier, if you look through any of the dynamics, the effects that you just post that information, I mean, brands are very, you know, cautious of having with the kind of narrative messaging that most people are getting, we have to start the wrong message. And you know, the thing about that, sorry, now, the thing about that, people make decisions switching that because of social media. So, once if I come out and say, if I have an influence, you know, by some people, my social media followers, and I come out and say, you know, the sky is red, and the sky is actually red, some people have almost 10,000 steps, the sky is red, but because I say so. And the wrong message. So it's important that you are able to put reality
Twitter says they want to introduce an edit button, right? And then people say, oh no, some people say yes. And the reason why people are afraid of an edit button is because there's already fake news. And then with an edit button, you can even be more fake, right? You can lie about things that are maybe that didn't happen. But as a media company that we all are, I think it's on us. We are responsible for the kind of content that we put out there. Because we won't wait until somebody else tries to control whether it's fake news or not. It's important that we verify things before we share. Recently, I was seeing posts about Oguntamu and Adeyemi's ideas. And it was worrisome, but I didn't pass on that reason. I didn't know if it was true or not. But if it's not, now you have to put people in. It's okay to,
yeah,
to find a balance between giving people sensitization and giving them reason to be aware of the environment. If it's also not true, people that are already very at the edge of panicking, living in Nigeria alone is already anxiety and so on. So when you're adding to it with fake news, I think we just need to be more responsible and citizens generally speaking.
Thank you so much for that, Simon. Okay, Penzaar, I know that you work with celebrities. You specialize in talent management. I don't know what you specialize in talent management, right? With your work that you do with them, what do you think that do you think that celebrities in any way impact fake news, so to speak, or do you think they play any role in reducing it or amplifying it in any way?
So I tell talents that I manage that before you make any posts, you need to be very sure, because you've got followers, you've got people that take your word for it. If you say the sky is red, they say it's red, you know. And then we are in the age where we've got fanatics, people who just want to follow you for anything, and then they're not even sure if they are following you in the right direction or not. So for celebrities, they've got a very major role to play, and that's why when there are protests, when there's a need for people to come out, they will call on celebrities, because it means that when they see the style of this thing, then they can follow, you know. So, same thing with fake news. So, I tell people that you need to verify before you make any posts about whatever is happening. So, that's why you find out that most celebrities that are not, they are careful what they put out, because you can either make them or ban them. Yeah. So, basically, the talent I manage, before they make any posts in regards to societal issues, I have to verify. I need to check to be sure that you're not just leading me in the wrong direction. So it's the thing. I mean, obviously, you've got the followership, you've got the numbers, and even the kind of content they create too. If you tell me that this is the best phone, mobile phone to use, then I and one of the reasons why brands engage influencers is because they are not personal. It's not a sponsored ad. It's not you just doing a graphic design. It's more personal. So when you have a celebrity post that this product is the best product to use, then I can go to the market to get it because you have said that. So, you know, yeah, so you will also need to be very careful as a celebrity or as a brand influencer, the kind of product that you sell. You need to use it. You need to. Now, the problem most influencers have is that they just get paid and they post. They don't even check to see if this product actually works or as good as what people or what the brand says it is as, you know. So it's a lot of it's a big role for celebrities. I won't even use celebrities, I would want influencers. It's a big role for influencers because, like I mentioned, we would take your word for it, and then if you move around, come back and say, hey brother, hey sister, that used to make a buyer, you know. So yeah, basically.
Thank you so much, Penzaar. So what we're still discussing, or the question we're still discussing, I'm coming to you now, is the implications of viral media for personal branding in a globalized world. I think that question for you is kind of personal, because you're a personal brand. You've put out a lot of tweets that have gone viral, you've been dragged, you've been lauded, among sort of things. So, yes, so what do you think? Viral media that I think that it has helped your brand, right? But I'd like you to just comment on how it has helped your brand, and especially, you know, the way that social media is today. How do you think that those viral content that you put out that has gone viral has helped your brand as a personal brand?
Okay,
what's smart, like the reason that works. It also works.
Wow, that's what I'm saying.
So it sticks, yeah. So it's not just an Android, faceless Android social. It's a lazy face to it, and it plays a name to it. So that actually works very well. And one thing I want to add is, now that the everything and anything can go viral nowadays, yeah, we have a TikTok, it's just one downstairs and boom. It's just one video and boom. It's just one person making one video and boom. You know, so I feel we should not be more intentional about whatever we post, because anything can go viral. You don't need any help of an influencer to, oh, please help me share your story. You actually don't need it. And to think that it's the most stupid things that go viral, so we just have to be very more intentional and
exactly. Pam, thank you so much for that. So I think at this point I would want to know, right? We've been talking about virality, but how important is virality in content creation, right? If we say, oh, virality is important, how can this be balanced with other KPIs? Because one of the things I think going on right now on social media is the content goes viral, but what is the content actually saying, right? Does it have value? Is it positively impacting lives, right, or spreading fear or anxiety? So I think that it definitely needs to be balanced. So Taiwo, I'm going to come to you. How important is virality and its importance? How can we balance it with other KPIs?
So
we're
content creator here, so I'm very careful with how I respond. I do not think that virality is the only metric to measure success of the content. Yes, because even the biggest influencers, not all their content go viral. So it's important to define what, you know, success is for your personal brand and for whatever content you're creating. The moment you try to like over romanticize virality, there's a lot of pressure that comes with that. I like to tell people that you just, you know, create content from what you naturally enjoy doing. So that even if it doesn't go viral, it's you know, waste your time, right? And if it does go viral, it's left to you to find a way to build a sustainable engine around that virality, because it's not going to happen every day. So if Pamilerin tweets something that moves, you must understand how to monetize whatever it is. Browse across and reach out to it based on what goes viral. And also, there's a reason why Instagram introduced a feature that allows you to hide your likes. Because they also understand that the pressure for virality is getting worse than right. So, you must not define your entire, I mean, there are so many KPIs. If one person sees your post about beauty or fashion or hair, and it genuinely drives them to take an action, you have done something. It's not until 200 million like sees your content. It's important to also know that if your content does not go viral, it does not mean you don't know what you're doing. Like, you need to calm down and not be just like, what's that, okay, yeah. So it's again very important to know that beyond virality, there are other things to look at. There are people that create brilliant content that you probably have never heard of it. Probably have never heard of them. It's doesn't mean they don't know what they're doing. So it's just probably not time for you to see it yet. Or like the algorithm is not supporting, they're not bringing it to your page. But so you just have to continue the way you're doing, whether or not you go viral. Virality is like an icing on the cake, but it's not the real cake itself. So
thank you so much, Taiwo. I think what you said about the importance of balance in terms of knowing that virality is not measurement of content, right? Virality is good, but there are other things that other KPIs, other things that we should look at in measuring how great the content. Penzaar, at this point, I'm going to come to you. Just to ping off what Taiwo just said, right? He has talked about content creators and has kind of looked at it from the personal branding
understand that you've got the target audience, right? And the brand also has got the campaign direction, basically. Some brands do not engage influencers that are popular on social media. Some brands don't operate that way. So it's not about how viral your content can go, it's about the content that you're creating for them. It's the choice inside the content that you want. It's the difference that I think that for tech influencers, they operate better in that space. Most tech influencers are not big. Their content will not go viral. Some of them will transition and all that, right? But it's not about the likes or the views. It's about the process, the end result, what makes their content different. So for brands that we work with, I remember the campaign we did for both. And we gave them a list of influencers, we gave them the big guys. I mean, you look at numbers, you look at market impressions and all that, but for that campaign, they didn't want the big guys. They just wanted the guys that would give them what they wanted. Do you understand? So, like I said, every campaign has got an essence, a reason. So you need to look out for influencers in quotes that are not big in numbers or in views, but will give you what you want. Now, in terms of for influencers. So I manage Bonashagi, right? And I would say that for Bonashagi, his content necessarily do not have to go viral. As a talent, as an influencer, you need just one or two contents to go viral. When they are viral, everybody knows you already, right? The next stage is to be consistent with what you are doing. That's why I love what I would say. You need to create content that you naturally enjoy. You know, not because it's going to go viral, because it's going to have 20,000 comments or 10,000 comments. For every influencer, especially comedy influencers, comic influencers on Instagram, they have their stages. At the moment, now, Sabino's is the river of the moment, right? And you go to Sabino's stage, and you realize that the trauma at engagement that Sabino's enjoying now, the marriage at the same thing. Macaroni had the same thing, but actually had the same thing. It's like we had the same thing, right? But you realize that variety at times is, it has a time frame.
Yeah.
You know, everybody loves river movement. Everybody loves this person because this person is the one. So, and same thing with music. Now it's Ashake, right? Because Ashake's songs, in quotes, are viral. Everybody loves it. But again, it might not be Ashake next year. So do not think of what, I think I was having a question with my PA when I was coming here that, when I was driving down here that there are many artists that we don't hear of anymore. And he mentioned to me that no, it's not because they're not giving up, they're not releasing songs. It's because their songs are not top 10, top 20. But they're still making money. So eventually think of how to monetize the content rather than working so hard to go viral. Because eventually your content being viral does not mean that people love it. So you need to ensure that your content is what's the word now? It's sweet, it's a juice. Yeah, it's a juice because that is what people remember. Do you know what I'm saying? So it's not about viral. But like I mentioned, it helps. But don't make that your
thank you so much, Penzaar.
Okay.
Penzaar just gave us like a test.
So I'm going to add something. So there's some content that go viral. So I'm going to give an example of one of the clients I managed, Shaggy. I'm going to give an example. The first content that you, Shaggy, quote, he's been doing several contents before, that we released several contents before, but Shaggy has done, I'm going to give back, you've done a couple of others, right? But he did one skit that he had at Shaggy interviewing him, and the skit was about Jesus. Who is Jesus in Mushi? What would you do? I said, Jesus, I'm Yoji, blah, 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 acted and all that. Now, people came for him and said, yeah, Jesus, you are doing this, blah, 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 and all that. Now, what I'm going to say is that he didn't mean that he had to continue with Jesus' narrative, but he continued, he realized that, okay, fine, they don't like this that I used. I mean, first of all, the content went viral, right? That's what I'm talking about. But people did not really like the fact that he played around the Jesus thing. But again, he had the comments, he had the likes, he had the engagement. So he had to focus on the kind of content and not necessarily that exact message.
Thank you so much, Penzaar.
Something that you don't own or that you did not create.
monitor. It's important to have, even if you don't have the knowledge, to have people around you that have legal knowledge. So you might not be able to afford to put a lawyer on your retainer, but you can have a lawyer friend that you can call that, okay, I'm creating this thing. What can happen if somebody else uses this thing? You also need to be protected as a creator. So people, I see content that I've seen before on so many people's pages. People are making money off another person's content and they are doing nothing about it because they don't have any legal representation. So it's important that once you know that you want to be a content creator, you want to do it very, very frequently, you will encounter copyright issues. And it's important that you have someone you can call and say, this person posted my video without consent. This person used my content without telling me. What should I do about it? Can we make money? Can we sue this person as well? Money? So you will save yourself a lot of stress by having legal advice. It's one of the first things I did when I run a platform called Room to Me, and we had a lot of issues because it's basically curating content from people that are, you know, established and using that to educate emerging talents. And there are times where somebody will send you a DM or you posted something that, you know. So the first thing that we did was to hire a lawyer. Like, it's important that you have somebody that can give you, because we don't know everything. You can't know everything. So if you can, if it's your friend or your girlfriend or your boyfriend or your mom, anybody that has legal understanding, talk to them more often when you're creating something that has potential for virality.
Thank you so much, Taiwo. I think what you just said, please, a round of applause. What you just said is so pivotal, you know, because a lot of people don't take it seriously. Especially when people just create content from the comfort of their homes, they think there's no legal implication. But these things are changing, right? People are getting sued for the things you can't even imagine. But we're running out of time, so I'll just quickly go to the last question before we take questions from the audience, right? Penzaar, you have been in this business for a minute. What do you think, with everything that has happened in the last decade, what do you think the trends will be in the next, say, 10 years?
So, we'll have shorter content, shorter videos, right? You know, there was a time you have to create content about 5 minutes, and then became 2 minutes, 30 seconds, 10 seconds. So I think that even in 5 seconds, you could pass a message. Yeah, so I think we'll have shorter, because attention span is getting shorter. You know, I'm on Instagram now, and content are fighting each other. Because I'm seeing content from somebody's page, I'm seeing content from another person's page. So I think that people don't even have time to consume enough, you know. So I think that there just isn't going to be a change in the kind of content. I don't know. I mean, maybe I just feel that it's absolute content. I don't know what, but I know, I'm very sure that because of the attention span, the kind of content that will consume in years to come is going to be shorter. Yeah.
What you just said about attention span is interesting because it's actually scientifically proven. People who research on social media have said that people's attention spans are not shorter. So it's important that the content you put out becomes shorter for consumption. So, do you want to comment on that? Trends in the next 10 years.
None of us are succeeders, so we don't really know what would happen. 10 years ago, nobody knew that there would be a platform that you'd be imitating somebody and it would go viral, and that's TikTok, right? So I think whatever the trends will be, whatever whatever they are, it's important that we learn to adapt to whatever it is. We should not think that we are superior to a platform, or that that's where your attention is, and we just follow the attention wherever you are, Gen Z or Gen Alpha, whatever it is. It's important that you cannot read it. It's probably going to be
the metaverse.
You probably will be creating content in another world that you don't know yet, in another 10 years. Even if you don't know what that means yet, you didn't know what double tap meant for 10 years ago, right? So, whatever it is, it's important to be ready to adapt. And if you are real estate or tech or finance or whatever it is, don't say anything is cool.
Yeah, there will be that culture shock. You'll be like, for example, I was like, I'll never use TikTok, period. But along the line, you realize that even if you can do it,
hire somebody who can do it, because that's your market is there. Just follow the attention, whatever is trying to happen.
Oh, sorry, my bad. My bad, I like hearing your voice. Pamilerin, please.
We have a lot of more content creators, yeah, because it's acceptable now. I mean, proud content creator, you ask everyone who tell you I'm a content creator, we come there anywhere you go to, you see ring lights everywhere, look to you,
and
the rest of it. So I think now people don't want to go to universities anymore, they want to go to business schools. Taiwo went to a business school, you know, so people are still want it. So no, I don't think you want to be lawyers, doctors, and whatever, anyone, everyone wants to be content creators, so you just have to be intentional about the kind of content you push out and moving forward years to come. We see a lot of content creators that we have to start writing for space.
Can I quickly just add what you want to talk
about? Perhaps I'm saying.
So, yes, content creators will be more creative years to come because, like you said, or like I said earlier on, there will be a clash of attention, you know, so you have to be more creative and more intentional about what you do. That's one. Two is that content creators will make more money. You know, before now, we never knew commoditized content, but people are making a lot of money on Facebook, on YouTube, and other platforms. So you don't even have to be an influencer anyway to get engaged by brands. Monetization will grow bigger, you know, in years to come.
Thank you so much.
I think it's very important for us that might be somebody out here, might be anybody on this panel, that we should start looking into something. I hope to do really soon, open to own creative schools in Africa, where people go to school learning geography, then go like go to school and get a BA in photography, get a BA in videography. Because now what we have is a lot of medical doctors, a lot of psychologists that are coming to explain somebody else.
They are doing both actually, you know, professionals that are creating.
Exactly, so when you're going to school, like, check, and Google what they call for sale is a creative school in the US, where once you go to school, you'll be on your IT project might be, it will be like Wakanda. Even on that project, your life cannot be really seen. You understand? So we need this kind of experience in Africa where people go to school and learn photography. Then we will now have a broader environment ecosystem where a doctor will focus on doctoring.
Yeah.
When I'm going to school, I know I'm going to learn photography. When I'm going to school, I know I'm going to learn fashion. When I'm going to school, I know I'm going to learn content creation. And that would be nice.
Thank you so much today. Thank you, gentlemen. It was really great discussing this topic with you. And now we're going to take questions from the audience. I'm sure we've learned a lot from this panel.
Let's just take two questions, please. So people who haven't asked questions before, last session you asked a question. So one and two, because time is up and we need to get to lunch and we still have two more panel discussions. So your name, what you do, your question, and who it's for, and then we'll take the second question and give a chance to our panelists to respond. In the meantime.
Okay, I want to ask.
May I just introduce yourself?
Okay, my name is Chantel. Okay. My name is Chantel. And I just wanted to ask in terms of copyrights, like maybe like a creator like myself, now I can post something online and then maybe a bigger creator you work with can copy that and lift it off and, you know, to credit, you know, for us, like maybe when we potentially become viral, you know, but then most of those people that are already there and then they take stuff from maybe small content creators like us, so to speak.
Why you direct your question to exactly?
Take the second question and then we'll have a chance for my panelists to respond.
Okay. My name is Tunde. I'm in Comedian. Okay. I, from observations and interaction with content creators, I realized virality can be the beginning of mental health issues. I would like to know, I know that a lot of content creators, at the point when they go
thank you. Can we put 5 minutes on the clock just so that we can guide our panelists? Because I know that second question is for all five of them, and the first question for Penzaar. Thank you.
I know that's what
the first question, copyright question. So I think that you need to. So when you're creating a content, you know how deep. I mean, at times we don't even know how big this model creating would become, but I think that you should be open to trademarking. So when you trademark, it's easy for getting the Google person to trademark your content, and it's easy, like having those trademarks is, you know. So basically, I think that's what it is. Whether the person is bigger creator or emerging talent or smaller creator, eventually if you trademark your content or your style and what makes you different, because we all have got what makes us unique. And there's nothing you cannot trademark your name, you can trademark your style, whatever. So I think that's my response.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Most times they don't even do it with their friends, like my guy, point the case, match
that. That's what I'm saying, that when it goes, I don't want you to go viral, but when you release the content and you know that this is a good product, you can think of.
But just quickly answer that. Okay. Please go ahead.
Mark a lot of names, right? But you can't trademark an idea. Yeah. Right? So if you say in your video, you say something or you dance a certain way or you dress a certain way, I don't know what specifically you do in terms of content creation, and someone else does the same thing, it's just that the game is the game. You have no, like, if you go to court, there's no way to prove that you're the originator of what you did, right? So first of all, you must be willing to take some years on this journey. It's going to get better, right? You're going to get to a level where you probably, the cases will reverse, but be willing to take some of those things and say, you know what, nothing goes.
Thank you so much. Just before the second question is answered, I just need to quickly add that trademarking is not very expensive, right? You might think it is, but it's not as expensive as people think it is. And I'm saying this from a legal perspective because I study law, so just to put it out there.
Thank you.
Second question. Well, Pamela, I actually think you're very good at this question because they've dragged you. They've dragged you.
I think that it's a very subjective question. Like the way I would deal with it is different from the way. But can you ask your question again? There's something you said I'm trying to remember. So there was a context that.
It starts with virality. Because virality brings attention to.
Yes. I like the question because it's one of the things that's very, very passionate to me. And I like preparing people for fame. Because it's one of the reasons why I built the road to the Prof Transform, right? Because there's nothing that prepares you for that kind of life. I also manage talent. I work with people that are very popular. And I see how they handle these things. They don't handle it well. Like, it gets to them. If you randomly tweet at a celebrity something that is not very kind, and you think because they're celebrities, you know, they're just going to accept it, this still actually gets to them. You'll be surprised, they might clap back at your Twitter, but it actually really hurt them. So it's nothing prepared them for it. They just wanted to entertain you, and then the side effect of entertaining you is that it got popular. And now they have to deal with not being able to walk on the street anymore. They can't buy bully, and you know, it's a difficult life, and nothing prepares anybody. So there is no solution right now to answer this question. It's something that I'm trying to work on. Like, also talk to other creators, like, and other platforms and brands that there needs to be. So people come out of Big Brother into a life that they were never prepared for. It's incredible to even think of. Like, do you know the privilege you have that you can walk on the street and nobody's harassing you? I know you want it, but you should enjoy it while you have it. So nothing prepares us, and it takes a toll of mental health. And one of the people I represent is even very, very big. That's insane. And when we talk, we kind of see a reason why, even in America, there is nothing. So who Smith slaps somebody on stage and they blame it on his mental health, right? And even there is nothing that's prepared who Smith that there will be a day that somebody will say something wrong to him and he will react that way. So it's there is no one answer to it. You don't know what you can do under the pressure of fame. And if you can afford it, whenever these things are getting to you, talk to a therapist or talk to a professional that can help you get better.
Thank you so much, Taiwo. Come on, do you comment?
I think what that is very important, but like you say, with Smith, everybody listens to what you do.
Yeah.
And if they slap somebody, you went down the train, like, it's bad for so many people, lost so many stuff, you know, and that's sad part of life, and it's what will happen when you get into fame. I think the only thing I can say is most times when you see content where people post stuff and they make it seem passionate, they usually always make it so you can see people doing the negative and maybe another 50, 80 doing the positive, but most times we always focus on the negative. So I think my own suggestion would be, why not just focus on the positive? Try to train your mind. I know it's hard, but try to train yourself to blow away the negative and focus on the positive. Let the positive be your reinforcing.
So much, Taiwo, and I'll just add that you need to know who you are before you go into content creation. Because when you know who you are, when people say things about you that are incorrect about your person, it doesn't get to you because you know who you are regardless, right? So it's very, very pivotal that you know who you are, and you just navigate the rest as it comes. So thank you so much, everyone. I hope that you learned one or two things. It was great talking to you, gentlemen. Thank you.